Are you dealing with a mother-in-law who badmouths you? Struggling with overbearing opinions at every family gathering? Wondering what it takes to actually be a good mother-in-law? Today, we've got 21 burning boundary questions that will help transform your most challenging relationships. The questions and timestamps are in the description. Let's dive in. Question number one, how do I handle a mother-in-law who paints me in a bad light to my husband? It's crucial that you and your husband are on the same page. You have to be a united front when you're setting your boundaries. It's not really about handling your mother-in-law directly. It's about making sure your husband's got your back. For example, if your mother-in-law says something nasty or negative about you, your husband could say, "Mom, don't talk badly about my wife like that. If you continue, I'm going to end our visit or I'm going to hang up the phone." This united front will help you relax knowing that he's going to stand up for me. I remember my friend Laura had the same issue, and once her husband stepped in, his mom got the message. It made all the difference. But that's what I would do. What would you do? As we go along with these boundary questions, put your thoughts in the comments. Boundary question number two, how often should you see your grandchild if you only live 20 minutes away? Oh, I can feel your desire wanting to see your grandchild more. There is not a magic number about how often grandparents should be able to see their grandchild. It all depends on the parent's comfort level. But if you want to see them more, ask the parents. Have an open conversation with them and just say like, "Hey, would you guys be open if I took Bobby to the park one night a week?" The key is to make it clear that you are offering help. Like, take something off their plate and you're not imposing or being a burden on them. And just remember, the entire time you're respecting their comfort levels. My neighbor did this, and as soon as she could find specific tasks that she could be helpful with, it worked wonders. Question number three, how do I navigate a daughter-in-law with mental health concerns who behaves aggressively at times? So dealing with family members who have mental health concerns, that requires patience and understanding. First, I would check out two books, Stop Walking on Eggshells and the second book, I Hate You, Don't Leave Me. These resources will be very, very valuable in terms of providing insight. But when she behaves aggressively, try saying the line like, "I see you're upset and I'm here to help." What this does is acknowledges her feelings and it offers support without escalating the situation. I had a client use this technique with a family member and it helped immensely. Question number four, how do you gain closure when a boundary doesn't go well and you have to distance yourself? So what this tells me is that she probably set a reasonable boundary with an unreasonable person and they escalated to the point where now she has to create distance for either her own mental health or safety concerns. So closure often comes with grief. You have to accept that someone you cared very deeply about has shown you a side that you didn't even know existed. So it's a process of coming to terms with the fact that now distance is your only option. So keep in mind that it's for right now. This means that in the future, the situation could change, but allow yourself to grieve and accept the reality of the situation for right now. I'm really sorry that it happened like this with you and your family member. I remember when a dear, dear friend had to distance herself from a toxic relationship. It was so hard in the beginning, and the boundary guilt is no joke, but it was a necessary step. Question number five, how do you tell a forgetful mother-in-law that she can't watch your two-year-old alone without offending her? If this was my mom, I would have a gentle heart-to-heart. For instance, I would say, "Mom, like, we love that Alex gets to come and play with you, but she's into everything right now, so we feel more comfortable if there's another person around to help keep an eye on her." But I would make it super personal and very gentle. If it's your husband's mom, like you're saying, he needs to handle the conversation. This is a tough one, but I've coached many families, especially with grandparents who have undiagnosed ADHD, and they get really distracted pretty easily, and they just have had to put their baby's safety first. Before we get to the mother-in-law who talks about the high school girlfriend at every family event, I want to welcome you. If you're new to the channel, welcome. And if you're an OG, you know that I'm a boundary enthusiast that believes very firmly that boundaries fix almost everything. If you're interested in learning more about boundaries and how they can transform your life, hit that subscribe button and stick around. Okay, back to question six. What do you do about a mother-in-law who keeps bringing up the high school girlfriend at every single gathering? This is a tough one, but my gut says approach it with empathy. I would pull her aside. I would say, Linda, I can tell you had a really close relationship with Janessa, but I want you to know it makes me so uncomfortable when you bring her up so often. Like, I don't think you're trying to upset me, but it really does. If we could minimize it a little bit or even avoid these mentions, I would really appreciate it. Now, if she keeps bringing it up, then I would just politely remove myself from the conversation. So if I'm sipping a lemonade at the barbecue, I'd just be like, oh, I need a refill, and I would just exit. Question number 7, how do you handle in-laws who are conversational narcissists? Full transparency, I had no idea what this was. I was like, is this a new thing? Because to me, a narcissist is a narcissist. I don't have like specific terms for it. But if you're like me and you're wondering, what is that? It's just a person that makes every conversation about them. So you know the person. So the first thing you need to do is accept that they're gonna likely focus on themselves when you go see them. So don't expect them to be interested in your life and you won't be let down. But if you need their attention or their opinion on something, you can gently steer the conversation back to you. You can say, I appreciate you sharing, but I really need some help with my situation. But accepting their behavior can make visits less disappointing. But if that doesn't work for you, you might have to change up your visiting schedule. Either make them shorter, less frequent, just kind of play with it a little bit to your comfort level. So I had a grandpa like this. Every visit would end up with him being the storyteller to an audience of one. Me. And that's just how it was. I didn't try to change him. I didn't take it personal because literally it had nothing to do with me. Like, hello, he was obsessed with himself. And I saw it for what it was, just a great opportunity for me to spend time with my grandpa and learn about his incredible life. I guess I just turned it into a moment of gratitude that I got to be with him and I didn't take it personal. Boundary question number 8. How many times do you try with in-laws who dislike you before you just call it quits? I'm ready, but my husband is not. Well, there's no set number. It's about how it affects you. So if it's unhealthy, you just have to limit your exposure. You can tell your husband, I do want a relationship with your parents, but it's damaging me. So like, I'll join you once a month. You can go as often as you want. But like for me, it's just once a month. Therapy might also help just kind of like work out these feelings. That's my take. What's your take? Do you feel like there's a magic number of tries? One of my listeners shared a story one time that once a month really helped improve their mental health dramatically. At first, it felt like her in-laws were winning, right? Because now they just got the husband all to themselves. But I reframed it and said, no, if someone mistreats me that way to that degree, they don't get to spend time with me. Question number 9. Is it possible to build a relationship with your daughter-in-law who doesn't seem to want one? Yes. Keep showing up as your loving self because over time, she might open up more or life events might bring you guys closer. It's more about her than you. But for more insights, check out episode number 8. I've seen this work in countless families where initially the daughter-in-law kept their distance, and this could be for sometimes years, but gradually she opens up and then there's a relationship there. Question number 10. How do you respectfully decline an extended family's vacation invitation from parents who have no boundaries? I would say thank you so much for the generous invite. We are not up for a trip right now, but we would love to do a day trip. Like, we would love to get together. Like, maybe we could go to the ice cream shop. Remember, a couple hours away. We loved that when I was little. I've had to do this myself. And by offering an alternative suggestion, it kind of like just takes the zing out of the disappointment just a little bit. Question number 11. How do I handle a mother-in-law who buys things for our child, but keeps them at her house? You could try a couple things. First, ask your husband to set a boundary with his mom. Like, I would just say, mom, it's confusing to our child to receive gifts, but then they stay here. So just don't present them as gifts. Alternatively, once your kid gets older, you could educate them and just say, when grandma gives you things, like her things stay at her house, and just kind of educate them so that your kid expects to always leave things there. Question number 12, how do you deal with a mother-in-law who kisses your baby even though you've told her countless times not to? The first thing that comes to mind is to hold your baby when your mother-in-law is around. And if she asks why, you can say, well, Linda, I've asked you not to kiss my baby and you keep doing it. So in order to hold my line, I'm gonna hold my baby. And obviously it's going to be uncomfortable at first, but eventually after the boundary has been reinforced over time, your mother-in-law is going to find other ways to show affection. Question number 13, how do you handle in-laws with strong personalities and overbearing opinions? opinions. I guess for me, I would have to manage the frequency and the duration of the visits so that it's something that I could handle. So if seeing your in-laws is draining you to zero and you're seeing them weekly, try every other week. If you're seeing them every other week, try once a month and just see how long does it take for me to fully recharge. I would also accept they just have strong opinions, and people typically with very strong opinions that like everybody to know about their opinions don't want to hear about your opinions. So I wouldn't try to have conversations about very hot topics. I would stay in the neutral zone. And if they give me unsolicited advice, I would just say, well, thank you so much for sharing. Like, we're going to do it this way. But again, thanks for sharing your opinion. One listener shared a similar situation like this, that when they had a set time limit for the visits, that really helped decrease like the stress. And then she just focused on neutral topics like movies and local events to avoid conflict. This next one is a lot, but I first want to check in to see how you're doing. Like, have you learned anything? Like, if you have, give me the thumbs up emoji in the comments. And if you've learned two things, definitely share this with a friend or a family member. Okay, back to question number 14. How do you handle in-laws expecting to see their son every other weekend and inviting themselves over? So you and your husband first need to set the balance that works for both of you. If every other weekend is too much, suggest a schedule that suits both of you, like once a month. And when they invite themselves over, just politely decline and say, sorry, we're busy, but we really look forward to seeing you next weekend or next month, whenever it's scheduled. But how do you guys manage frequent visits from family? I mean, I think that's kind of what I would do. My best friend was faced with this, and she found that setting very clear and consistent boundaries helped a ton. It was just avoided misunderstandings. It was a healthier balance. It gave everybody something to look forward to and less overwhelm in general. Question number 15, what can you do if your mother-in-law visited your three-month-old after a COVID exposure and lied about it to your face? I think the first thing you need to see is that this behavior shows where her priorities lie. So moving forward, you're just gonna be more cautious and understand that you can't fully trust her on her word. So for example, back when COVID was everything we talked about, a listener had a family member, I'm pretty sure it was a father-in-law, did the same thing. And then going forward, while their baby was young especially, they would have him provide a negative test before he could visit. But in the middle of a visit, if you suspect someone's not feeling well, you have every right to say, we are gonna need to cut this visit short and continue when everyone's feeling better. We're just trying to keep our baby safe and healthy. Question number 16, how do you handle a mother-in-law who ditches family plans if she gets a better offer? Yikes. I do know someone who also went through this, something similar. It's hard to believe, but it does happen. What they did is they just started to invite her mother-in-law to things that it's great if you come, but her absence doesn't impact the event if she misses. For example, if they're gonna go to a picnic, a trip to the zoo, invite mom along. But then if she cancels, it's okay because now we just have more focused family time. Question number 17, how do you prepare to be an amazing mother-in-law? I have four sons. The fact that you're asking this question, I have a gut feeling you're going to be a great mother-in-law. Start off with open communication. My mother-in-law did this. She did an amazing job. She sat me down, basically said, like, I'm here for you. You can come to me for anything, but also build a personal relationship with your daughter-in-law through shared activities, go for coffees, shopping, nails, I mean, just anything. But mother-in-laws, what tips do you have for this newbie? Drop your wisdom nuggets in the comments. I mean, I've seen my own mom who she's an incredible mother-in-law, and she does this by creating really strong bonds. She just simply is there for them when they need it. She's there to be a shoulder to cry on. She's such a support system. I mean, basically to everybody in her family, but that's definitely what she does for all of her daughter-in-laws. Number 18, how do you handle a sister-in-law refusing to be around your step-sibling's children without explanation? You're gonna have to respect her boundaries. Even if you feel like this is manipulative, you should still include her and just accept her choice if she declines. For example, continue to invite her to the birthday parties, baptisms, all the events, but understand if she chooses not to attend. I had a colleague who faced a similar situation and found that just by maintaining that open invitation without pressure eventually led to more open communicating and understanding. Question number 19, how do you handle a mother-in-law getting a baby room ready at her house thinking, I'm gonna babysit here and not at your house? Well, this happened to me. I hadn't created a nursery yet, and I guess I just wasn't in the nesting mood, but it was definitely hit me weird. But once I like wrapped my head around it, I was super grateful for it. To have everything available there and the fact that we could just grab our baby and go there and not load up the entire nursery in our car just to be able to go for a visit, it was a godsend. So to me, it was like grateful. I would not say anything now. You can set the boundary when it comes time to babysit. I would say, actually, I would prefer if you could watch Sophie here when I'm working. I'm just not comfortable with her being away from me yet. And then if she brings it up, you can just calmly reiterate your preference. Question number 20, we're almost there. How do you hold boundaries with a mother-in-law who harasses your husband until he folds? Tell your husband, stop folding. This is about your husband holding his boundaries and retraining his mother so that no matter how much she pushes, he will not fold. For example, he might say, Mom, I've made my decision. Continuing to push is not going to change it. Consistency is key. I remember a client who dealt with this, and with consistent effort, her husband eventually reinforced his boundaries successfully. Question number 21. How do you handle a father-in-law who treats her husband horribly, but not your brother-in-law? This is so painful. And honestly, it might require professional support. Like, I would encourage your husband to talk to a therapist and process his feelings about this. You can also set a boundary. Like, if your father-in-law is talking to you directly about your husband, you could say, Frank, it hurts me when you say these comments about Scotty. I prefer that you don't discuss or talk about him in that manner with me. You could also have shorter, more frequent visits. That might help. I know one of my friend's husbands went through this and found that therapy was incredibly helpful for her husband to navigate these family dynamics, but it was really helpful for her because she also went along with. So it was just a very, very healing process. And that's a wrap. That's today's boundary Q&A. I hope these answers empower you to set firm boundaries and strengthen your in-law relationships. If you have a boundary question, you can leave me a voicemail. So I will leave that. I'll pin it in the comment below. Don't forget to hit that subscribe button, the notification bell. That way you know when the next episode drops. Until next time, friend, make sure you keep minding your boundaries.